Hi, once again. This is part 2 of the video on hypothesis formulation. This is M.K. Sharma from the Department of Business Administration, Tezpur University. So, you must remember that this is a very basic discussion targeted to the management students, and we discuss in the first part about the belief that is converted into statistical expression in order to check if our intuition is correct. That ideally we formulate the null hypothesis before starting the data collection, not the null hypothesis, both the hypothesis, null and alternative. We'll talk about that later. But sometimes what happens that a hypothesis can also be formulated when we have large number of data in our hands, and we find suitable hypothesis for the data that we have already collected. We have two types of hypothesis. One is null hypothesis, the other one is the alternative hypothesis. And we have got two very basic formats of hypothesis. One is written as there is no relationship between two variables, that is, you may say that X and Y. Or you can write the same hypothesis, same null hypothesis, as that variable X and variable Y are independent. So the alternative hypothesis for this particular null hypothesis would be there is a relationship between the two variables. There is a relationship between X and Y. And if you have written the null hypothesis as variable X and variable Y are independent, then we write the alternative hypothesis as variable X and variable Y are dependent on each other. So we talked about the example. I hope you remember that example, that our belief was that a male consume less perfume than the females. We have got gender measured in nominal scale. It has taken two forms. One is male, the other one is female. And consumption of perfume is also measured in nominal scale. High consumption of perfume, medium consumption of perfume, low consumption of perfume. Let me make it very clear here that we can measure consumption of perfume in ratio scale also. And in a first video we talked about it. But at this moment we presume that consumption of perfume is measured in nominal scale. So the belief is this: the males consume less perfume than the females. Therefore, what would be the null hypothesis? The null hypothesis would be written like this: the gender and consumption of perfume are not related. So we stopped with example 2. I hope you could write the null hypothesis clearly. The belief was that males prefer cola flavor more than the females. Can you find out what are the two variables which are written here? One is the gender, as you could guess. The other one is the flavor of carbonated drink. That is a preference to a particular flavor. Preference to a particular flavor can be measured like, you know, cola flavor, orange flavor, lemon flavor, just sweetener or mango flavor. So all these different flavors are names, and therefore we say that a flavor is measured in nominal scale. So therefore, how do you write the null hypothesis? We write the null hypothesis as gender and preference to flavor are not related. We can also write like that. What can you write? We can write that gender and preferences to flavor are independent of each other. So if you write the null hypothesis as gender and preferences to flavor are not related, how do you write the alternative hypothesis? We'll write the alternative hypothesis as gender and preference to flavor are related. Or we write that gender and preference to flavor are dependent on each other. So this is how we write the first format of hypothesis. And then this is probably, you could find out that when we are dealing with two variables which are measured in nominal scale, then it is easier for us to write the hypothesis like this. And this is a procedure that we write the null hypothesis like this. And what test of measurement, even though it is premature to talk about the test of testing of the hypothesis, but then we say that this, you must understand that this hypothesis can be tested using chi-square test, using chi-square test. So we'll talk about that in another video, but at this moment just the knowledge of chi-square would be enough for you. When we are using a hypothesis like this, you always remember that we test this hypothesis with a chi-square analysis. So let's go to the format 2. This format is applicable when we are not only dealing with nominally scaled variable. At least one of the variables are measured either in interval scale or in ratio scale. Now, when a particular variable is measured in interval scale or in ratio scale, what happens is that you can always find out the means without any error. So when you are interested in comparing means of two groups or more than two groups, or means of two variables or more than two variables, what do? We go for this type of hypothesis formulation. So this hypothesis formulation looks like that. That the population mean of variable X and population mean of variable Y are equal. Our belief might be that a particular variable has got a higher average than another variable, that is variable Y maybe. But then we write in our null hypothesis as that there is no difference in the mean of these two particular variables. So in symbolic format we write like that, mu X is equal to mu Y. What is mu? Mu is the population mean of variable X. And what is mu Y? Mu Y is the population mean of the variable Y. So mu X is the population mean of the variable X and mu Y is the population mean of variable Y. So there is a difference between sample mean and the population mean. We probably, you know the differences. When we are talking about descriptive statistics, we talk about sample mean. When we talk about inferential statistics, then we talk about population mean. Now, from the characteristics of the sample, we want to infer about the characteristics of the population. Therefore, we have written the hypothesis. That is a basic job of hypothesis. And in video part 1, we talked about that. So, if we want to compare the means of two variables or two groups within the same variable, we write the null hypothesis like this. So when we write the null hypothesis like this, we write the alternative hypothesis just the opposite. What is the opposite of that? Not equal. It is not equal. So in the symbol also, we are writing that mu X is not equal to mu Y. So let me make one thing very clear here, that when you are writing the form a hypothesis in format 2, when you are dealing with the means of two variables or means of two groups, then you can use not only equal sign in the null hypothesis, you can use greater than equal to or less than equal to, but the equal sign must be there. It is allowed. But in that case, in the alternative hypothesis, what you will have to do, you will have to write just the opposite of what you have written. So in the first part of the video, we talked about that, you know, the conditions which are there in the null hypothesis that is equal to, and what is there in the alternative hypothesis that is not equal to, the options must be exhaustive. That means there must not be any other option left behind. So if you write the null hypothesis as mu X is equal to mu Y, and if you write the alternative hypothesis as mu X is not equal to mu Y, instead of that if you write mu X is greater than mu Y, then what happens to mu X? What is the possibility of happening mu X is less than mu Y? That means all our options are not exhaustive. So all the options that you write either in the null hypothesis or in the alternative hypothesis, both of them taken together, there should not be any option left behind. In statistics, as I told you in the first video, that this is known as collectively exhaustive. And along with that, we also know that both the options, both the hypotheses should be mutually exclusive as far as the options are concerned. No two options should be there in, or not a single option should be there. There should not be any common option between null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. So let us go for it. Then an example. The example is that, you know, that our belief is that males consume less perfume than the females. The same belief that we had as a first example, the males consume less perfume than the females. As we know, that gender is measured in nominal scale. Now this time we are measuring consumption of perfume in ratio scale. Remember, this time we are measuring consumption of perfume in ratio scale. So we say, we might say that how many cans of perfume somebody is using, how many milliliters of perfume somebody is using. We try to collect the data in that format, and then it is easier for us to find what? Find the average. So average of males and average of females. So thereby, with this information, what we can find out how many cans of average male is consuming, how many cans of perfume average female is consuming, how many bottles of perfume average female is consuming, and how many bottles of perfume males are consuming, or how much money they are spending in consumption of perfume or buying of perfume. What is the average between male and what is the average of female? So in both the cases, what do you do? We write the null hypothesis like this. Males and females consume equal amount of perfume on an average. If you talk about, if you collect the data in terms of how much it is, how much they consume in a particular period of time, that is, we write like this. Males and females consume equal amount of perfume on an average. So this is again, mu m is equal to mu f. What is mu m? Consumption of perfume in a particular period of time by male, and consumption of perfume in a particular same period of time by female. Mu m is equal to mu f. So alternative hypothesis is that mu m is not equal to mu f. Example 4. Belief is that students from different academic backgrounds score differently in RMB. Students from different academic backgrounds score differently in RMB. So we can have more than two groups: academic background, art, science, commerce, engineering, and score in RMB is ratio scale. So the hypothesis would be average RMB score is equal across all students from all backgrounds. And alternative hypothesis would be average RMB score is not equal across students from all background. The earlier example was of two groups. Here in this example we have got four groups. Mu E is engineering background students, mu C is a population average of commerce background students, mu A is a population average of arts background students, and mu S is the population average of science background students. So we hypothesize that these are equal, and our job, as you know, is to reject this null hypothesis to establish that our belief is correct, that is, students from different academic backgrounds score differently in RMB. Now see, one very minute thing is that we are not writing the alternative hypothesis in the symbolic form. We'll talk about that in detail, I hope, in a later video. I hope you could understand this as much as this is concerned. If you have got any query, you can send a comment. Also, you can send a WhatsApp message to me, or you can also write in the Google Classroom. Take care. Stay safe. Thank you very much for listening.